Good morning. I want to welcome everybody out to us, with us this morning that's here. We got several out. We've got a couple of family deaths this morning, and so we got some that are not here, but it's good to have y'all out with us, and we pray for those who are not here, and that just have our prayers this morning. And those that are not here for other means, we'll pray that they're all right and they'll be back next Sunday. Want to welcome also to Tim Sutton Trio will be with us this morning, and they're going to be singing some songs with us during their singing. And the service is going to be totally different from anything we've had, or this is the first time I've tried it, so if it gets a little mixed up, don't worry about it. It'll be all right. In the way of announcements this morning, there'll be no women's meeting in July and August. They put that off every year in July and August, so no women's meeting. There'll be no Bible study this week. Our choir practice, week of the 4th, we got several gone. The board meeting tonight, instead of over in the fellowship hall, the board meeting will meet here in the sanctuary. There are some extremely important issues we need to discuss on some things involving a lot of stuff that needs to be done to the church in the building. Some decisions are going to be made on some things. If you want to be part of those decisions, you be here. If you're not here, forever hold your peace, as you say when you get married. I tell you like I told them at Hoboken when we did some changes to the church down there. You got anything to discuss, you come to this meeting tonight, you discuss it at this meeting tonight, and then after that I don't hear a word about it, period. Keep it to yourself, between you and your wife, your husband, or your brother, your sister, whatever. Okay? Meals on Wheels this week in the back. Need to sign up to help with that. I'm not going to be able to help this week. I'm going to be attending one way or the other three different funerals, among other things, it looks right now. And my schedule is going to be full. So some of you that maybe hadn't signed up in a while for Meals on Wheels, pick out a date before you leave and sign up for that to help bet with that this week. Any other announcement this morning? Did I miss anything? All right. Let's take a moment now, if we would, this morning and look at our prayer list. We need to add Paul Meeks, Bobby Meeks' brother, Angie's husband's brother, passed away. So we need to keep the Meeks family in our prayers this morning. Brooke's sister, Mary Holloman, passed away this morning early. So we need to keep Brooks and the Holloman family in our prayers this morning. And Bobby Hall Ward, lady that lived in Virginia and came down here to stay with her daughter, she passed away this week. And her daughter's Baptist, good Baptist, but she wants a Methodist funeral. So I've agreed to do her funeral this week, so we need to be with our prayers need to be with the Ward family. Not that there's any difference in, you know, I've been to the Baptist funerals, there's any difference at all in between us and them. But anyway, this was her last wish, and this is what the family asked, and they asked if I would help, and I said yes. So as we look at our prayer list, we need to do that. Are there any others we can add to our prayer list this morning, or we need to take off of our prayer list? Any updates on those on our prayer list?
Terry has a co-worker, Paul Kirk, who had Lyme's disease.
Okay.
It's really bad all.
Okay, so we need to add them to our prayer list. How about others? Okay, if not, then let's go to the Lord in prayer. Gracious Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning and you've heard the needs that have been lifted up. You know the families that need your comfort, Lord, at this time. Lord, it's only you can comfort them in a way that you know that needs best. Father, you know the ones that were added to the prayer list with the Lyme disease, and then you know to those others on our prayer list that we're not aware of their particular problems at this time or just don't have room to write it all down, Lord. But you know, Lord, we don't need to write it down. When we pray for them, Lord, we pray for their healing. We pray for their wholeness. We pray for their families. We pray for the caregivers that are involved with them. And we just lift all their needs up to you, Father, for you to take care of them in a way that you know be best befittings each need. So, Lord, we pray for each one this morning that's on that list. We lift them up now to you for their needs. And, Father, if there are unspoken needs in this congregation this morning, whatever that unspoken need may be, if it's being lifted up right now, we join in lifting up that need as well and pray for the needs that are being lifted, Lord. We lift them up to you. Lord, we pray not only for those on our prayer list this morning and the families that have lost loved ones, but Lord, we pray for our nursing homes. We pray for those caregivers involved. We pray for the homebound. And Lord, we pray for our armed forces today. We pray for our government today, Lord. We pray for the decisions that are being made contrary to your word, Lord. We pray that you would give us godly men, that you would let godly men run for office, Lord, and that you would help them to be elected, that we could turn this country back around. We pray for the tragedies, Lord, that are going on in this world, the terrorism, Lord, the killings that are going on. We lift this up, Father. We pray for your intervention, Lord, in the way that you know best. We ask for also the unspoken needs here, Lord, as well. We pray for all this in Christ's name. Amen. At this time, I'm going to turn this over to the Tim Sutton Trio, let them introduce it. They're going to ask us to sing a couple of songs along the way, somewhere, wherever they so desire, that I gave Tim earlier with him. So we'll have some congregational singing. And somewhere around about 20, 25 minutes, I'll sort of wave my hand at him out down. I'll come back up and take over. Up until then, I'm going to turn it over to them.
Good morning. Good morning. Let's everybody stand. We're going to start out. Everyone, we're going to sing praises to our Lord and Savior. What an honor it is to be here in the house of God. We can worship and lift His name. And I'm thankful that God gave me Christian parents that took me to a Bible-believing church. And at a young age, at 8 years old, I asked Christ into my heart to be my Lord and Savior. And He forgave me of my sins right there and made me a new creature. You know, it's our job here on this earth, once we become His child, to serve Him. He wants to hear our praises. Let's lift His name up this morning, and we're going to sing Amazing Grace. What page is that, Tim?
My paper's on. I don't even know.
378. 378.
Through many days.
When we've been there 10,000 years, bright shining as the sun, we boldly gaze to see God's grace. Pages.
367.
I'm so thankful we have a Savior that reached down and touched me. Amen. What a wonderful Savior that we serve this morning. Amen. Amen. That even in this world that we live in today, I mean, it's been prophesied in the book of Revelation. God called John into his glory and showed him all the things that would be seen and done in these coming days. And we're already starting to see reflections of it now. Can I get an amen on that? I mean, obviously, by what we were talking in Sunday school this morning about Judgment Day and all the signs that we're seeing right now with homosexual marriage and all these different things that are coming up with our government and all over the world, I'm grateful that God made a way so that we wouldn't have to succumb to that judgment. Even though he said that all shall be judged, but you know what? It's up to us. If we choose to serve a risen Savior who bled and died on Calvary and lived again to tell this story, listen to his story, Yahweh.
Yahweh, Jesus is coming, born in Bethlehem. Is dying on the cross there. Our Lord is dying. Yahweh, Jesus is dying, dying for our sins, dying for our sins. Yahweh, Jesus is buried.
Baptized, felt the fire touch me and I'm satisfied. Let the ringing hands of the enemy. If you really know that he's washed you white as snow, if you know what it's really like to have a song in your darkest night, then lift up your voice in one accord and let the praise ring unto the Lord.
Let the redeemed
of the Lord say so. Chains of bondage,
into the land of promise,
dance with the heavenly manna,
dance for joy and gladness,
dance for joy and gladness. Oh, into the river and I'll be baptized, of the baptism we are satisfied. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. From me from the chains of bondage,
into the land of promise,
well, so glad to be here this morning. We're going to keep this thing going along. My name is Tim Sutton. This is Chastity. Y'all know her from Farmville, North Carolina. And the newest member of the group is Miss Taylor Graham from Pikeville, North Carolina. Make her welcome. And she's got to do good because her grandma's with her, so she's going to make sure we're all straightened out. So come here, Taylor, and sing this song.
How many of you all have heard about a man named Joe? Can you relate to him? I know I sure can. Listen to this. Now he had family, friends, and money, and loved the Lord with all his heart. So the devil went to God and said, oh, Job would fall apart. You should take away his fortune. Let me put him to the test. And soon poor Job, he lost his health and wealth and all the rest. And that's your love for me. Cause you got to count your blessings. You might want if you try. Count on the Lord and watch that blessing multiply. Cause those might have and could have and should have been are nothing but distressing. When you're down and out, it's time to count your blessings.
Amen, church. Well, listen to this next line.
Now you may go through hard times when you fall into despair. Just remember you're surrounded by his blessings everywhere. It's in a neighbor's helping hand or in the sunshine of a smile. One blessing leads to one more you'll be counting for a while. It's best to look at what you have. Forget what you have not, and just learn a lesson from old Job. Give thanks for what you got, cause you got to count your blessings. You find one if you try. Count on the Lord and watch that blessing multiply. Cause those might have and could have and should have been are nothing but distressing. So when you're down and out,
perfect love, one holy promise, and one
song talks about what John saw. And I can't help but think of Miss Mary Holloman today. And she's walking down the streets of gold. And she's seeing the face of Jesus. Amen. We'll sing this for her this morning.
John saw a city that could not be hid.
John saw the city.
Oh, yes, he did. John saw a glimpse of the golden throne.
Tell me all about it.
Go right on around the throne. He saw the crystal sea.
There's got to be more.
What will it be? I want to go to that city he saw, New Jerusalem. Streets that are golden, and I want to run where the angels have trod. Jerusalem, I want to rest on the banks of your river, in that city.
Lay down by the lamb.
I want to know everything about that land.
John saw the day, but he could not see night.
The Lamb of God, well, must be the light.
He saw the saints worship the great I Am,
crying, worthy, worthy is the Lamb.
I want to go that city he saw,
New Jerusalem. Jerusalem, I want to walk your streets that are golden, and I want to run where the angels have trod. City of God.
whatever your need is this morning, Jesus Christ can meet it. We're going to do one more song, and it's going to go with his message. It's a song I wrote. It's entitled, Touch Me, Lord. Whether it be spiritually, mentally, physically, financially, we all have needs. You know, Jesus Christ is the answer. He's the answer to this world, to the problems of this world. All we need is just to call upon him and say, touch me, Lord, for I need your healing hand. It seems that I've done all that I can do. There's nowhere else to turn. Through your word I've learned there's healing in your hand. You made the lame to walk again, and you caused the blind to see. So Lord, I'm calling out to you. I believe. Touch me, Lord. I need your healing hand. Touch me, God will pour you through. Get down on your knees and pray to our mighty King, and give all your burdens to the Lord. A miracle he'll bring. Touch me, Lord.
Touch me, Lord. I need your healing hand. Touch me, Lord.
Amen. Thank you. Tell you what, that was good. If we can have the ushers to come forward so we can move right along this morning and take up the collection offering, we would appreciate that. While they were coming up, I really want to thank the Tim Sutton Trio this morning. A wonderful time of worship. You know, if I don't preach, we've already got a message from God this morning. I want to thank you for your time and leave us from your home church to share a message with us this morning. We really appreciate that, really do. God's love. I don't reckon y'all can reach the offering plates, can you, if I don't hand them to you? I assume the Baptists take up offerings too, but good old Methodist churches take up offerings.
They go too. gracious Heavenly Father, we just thank you for this time that we've had here today to hear your word in psalm. And now, Lord, bless Claude as he delivers this message. Now, Lord, bless these offerings that we have received here today, that they will be used to glorify your name wherever they go. And, Lord, we love you, and God bless you. Amen.
Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. Christ is risen. This morning, the scripture is from Mark 5, 22-43, and I'm not going to read it all word for word. Hopefully most of you know this story, and I don't need to do that. So I'm going to skip some portions that put the story together for you. It's Mark 5, 22-43. Behold, there cometh one of the rulers of the synagogue, Jairus, by name. And when he saw Jesus, he fell at his feet. Now, Jairus would have been a most loved and respected man in this community. In fact, he would have been in this small town. He would have been the number one person. Everybody would have looked up to Jairus. He was the head guy of the church, the head guy of the synagogue, the pastor, the preacher, the whole nine yards for them. He was well respected in that community. And brought him and besought him, saying, My little daughter lieth at the point of death. I pray thee, come lay thy hands on her, that she may be healed, and she shall live. And Jesus went with him, and much people followed him, a large throng. And a certain woman with an issue of blood for 12 years, and 12 is important now. You need to know what 12 means in scriptures. 12 to the Jews and the Hebrews, we'll talk about 12 was very important. The age of 12 years, is an extremely important date in Hebrew history and their daily life. And suffered many things of many physicians, and had spent all she had, and was nothing bettered, but grew rather worse. When she had heard of Jesus, came in the press behind him and touched his garment. That was, she slipped up behind him and reached out and sneaked a little touch there. Now, Jairus is the most well-respected person in the community, and this woman is basically an outcast. She's considered unclean. She's untouchable. You don't touch her. With an issue of blood in the Hebrew history, she's unclean. If she's walking down the street, if the men know her, they're going to give her plenty of room. So are the women. They do not want to touch this lady. She's unclean. She's not as unclean as the leopards do. Leopards had to go around saying they were unclean. Unclean meaning they were unfit to touch. You can't touch me. I don't worry you lose your religion or not, but you had to go to the temple and be re-cleansed if you touch him. Unclean. She slips up and she touches him. You have the lead person in the community, and you have the shunned person in the community. Both have come to seek the touch of Jesus. She said, if I can just touch his clothes, I shall be made whole. And straightway that fountain of blood was dried up, and she felt within her that she had been healed of the plague. Of course, Jesus, immediately knowing he'd been touched, wanted to know who had touched him, and the disciples say, look, you know you got 50, 75, 80, 100 people gathered around you here, and we're pushing and shoving, and you want to know who touched you. You want to know who touched your clothes. And, of course, the woman confessed, and he said unto her, daughter, thy faith hath made thee whole. Go in peace, and be whole of thy plague. While he yet spake these words, the ruler of the synagogue's servant came to Jesus, and he told Jairus, don't bother the master any longer, your daughter's dead. Jesus said, don't worry about that. Don't pay him no mind. James, John, Peter, y'all come on, go and the rest of you stay here. We'll be back in a little bit. Don't pay him no mind. And so he goes to where the house of the ruler's house where the little girl's at. And when he came inside, he said unto them, why are you making such ado? They were beginning to weep and cry. Israel, the Jews, want a person died, they actually hired what they call wailers, criers. People were paid to come to the house and, and just cry and wail and Jesus, what are you doing? What is all this commotion? She is not dead. Get out. They look at him like he's crazy. Jesus put the unfaithful out. He put the unfaithful out. That's important now. He put the unfaithful out. He goes upstairs and he takes the damsel by the hand and he says unto her, Tabitha kumi, which means arise. And straightway she arose, got up and walked. He said, feed her. She's hungry. Go give her something to eat. Word of God for the people of God. A woman here, unclean. This woman is, so far as the community goes, is spiritually dead. For 12 years, she's as if she's dead. They don't want nothing to do with her. She's unclean. They can't touch her. Do they become unclean? For 12 years, she's dead to society. She can't go to parties or anything like that. She's a total outcast. You have a 12-year-old girl that is physically dead. Well, the dead to the Jews are also unclean. You don't touch a dead person either. They're unclean. So both of these women are unclean, so far as custom goes to the Jewish community. They both are 12 years. Now that's important. 12, by the way, 12 years in the Bible is used 189 times. You wonder how important it is. I tell my people, if you hear it once in the Bible, pay attention to it. If you see it twice, look at it. If you hear it three times, really pay attention to it. If it gets beyond three, you better start looking at what Jesus is talking about, what the Bible's talking about. 12 years, 189 times. It's an age, it's a time of change. 12 was a time of change in the Jewish life. It's a time when one became accountable for one's sins. The boys reach manhood. They then become a cat. That's where we as Methodists, I don't know about the Baptists, at 12 years of age, we say children become accountable for their own sins. Up until 12, parents are responsible for what they do wrong. Once they reach the age of 12, they become accountable. And they are responsible for their sins. Up until that time, their parents are responsible. This is what the Jews felt. When that child reached the age of 12, he had his bar mitzvah. He went to the synagogue. Jesus goes at the age of 12, remember. This little girl is 12 years old. Well, guess what? At 12 years old, a Jewish girl was usually betrothed. Betrothed, engaged in the Jewish community, was the same as if you were married. You just didn't sleep with him. Other than that, there was no difference. You had nothing else to do with another man. Another man had nothing else to do with you. You were strictly 100% committed to whoever the family betrothed you to. The little girl has reached the age of maturity. The woman, 12 years of blood issue, unclean. It's a number that meant change. Jesus wants to change Israel. The disciples are 12. And you keep reading the Bible and you'll find 12, 12, 12, 12. It's a time of change. It's an age of maturity. Jesus shows him that with him, that both physical uncleanliness, sin, can be healed. He shows that what we call death can be healed. Both are made alive again. Both live. Both, in a sense of the word, come back to life. This woman can now go to the well with the other women. She can go to the parties. She can go to the dinners. She can go to the weddings. She can do all the things that a living person can now do. The first touch that we saw here was initiated by an individual. It was initiated by her father. He reaches out and touches Jesus. You could say in prayer. He goes to him, Master, if you'll come, you can heal her. He reaches out in prayer. This first touch is initiated by an individual. I'm sorry, by the woman. Got ahead of myself. First touch is initiated by the woman, self-initiated. The second touch is initiated by an individual, prayer. The woman's reputation is gone. This man literally puts his reputation on the line for this little girl. Because I can tell you, in the Jewish community, Jesus at that time was not highly thought of. More than likely, Jairus is risking losing his position as being head of the synagogue, more or less head of the community or mayor of the town. People find out he's going to Jesus, and the bulk of them, just like they tried to run Jesus out of town and stone him, bulk of them don't want to listen to him anymore. He went to this itinerant, whatever, they don't know what to think of Jesus at this time. It took great faith for this woman to walk up behind Jesus and reach out and touch him in that crowd. It took great faith for this head man of the town, of the synagogue, to go to Jesus in this public crowd and publicly say, "Master, please, if you'll come." One of these individuals fits mine and your relationship this morning. We are in one of these categories. With all of our imperfections, with all of our blemishes, with all of our warts, with all of our uncleanliness, Jesus Christ, healer of the world, says that the only hope we have, the only hope that you have, is to touch and be touched. To touch and be touched. To touch and be touched and become as compassionate, a compassionate, a wounded healer with Jesus' help as he was. This is what every Christian should be. We should touch and be touched. In order for Christians to reach out and touch other people, which is what, that's our goal in life, that's what we're to do, we first must touch and be touched. We must either be touched by reaching out personally, or maybe through the prayers of someone else, maybe through the prayers of the church. Faith is not a religion. Faith should be and is a relationship with God. It's the relationship you have with God. In a sense of the word, I know we are not worthy of that attention of Almighty God, but he says that if we trust him, that he will heal us both spiritually and physically. You saw both healings here this morning, spiritually with the woman and physically with the young girl who had no sin at that time, according to the Jews. She's just reaching 12. So we see both healings take place. We see that the lowest reject in the community, the outcast, and women had no rights. Women were property back then. Not only is she an outcast, she's the lowest denomination in the community. Yet, she's healed when she reaches out to God, when she reaches out